أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدي وحبيبي ونور قلبي أبي القاسم محمد، اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين ذاب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم تنزيله: لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله. My dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Another day, another Friday to come together and first and foremost to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all His blessings. As His blessings never stop, regardless of how sinful we could be. His mercy continuously showering His blessings on our way. And for that matter, He deserves us to thank Him every moment for all those blessings. The blessings that we can see and the ones we can count and the ones we can't never even count. All praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those blessings. And we send our respect and salutation to the perfect human being Allah ever created, the greatest messenger, the beloved of Allah, Ar-Rasul al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. May the peace and blessing of Allah be upon him and his household, the chosen successors, the trusted individuals of the Prophet, and the ones who inherited the knowledge of Rasulullah, Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Peace and blessing of Allah be upon all of them. Ma salla ala. And may the Almighty Allah count us among the true of His servant, and may we all count us the true followers of the Prophet Muhammad and Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Allahumma salla ala. My dear brothers and sisters, another Friday to remind one another about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the very basic teachings that lead to fear Allah and have Allah in mind is to always keep in mind that Allah sees and watches. And He knows all the details of what we do, from the smallest action to the greatest action in this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Luqman, and the voice of Luqman talking to his son, where he says, Ya Bunay, my son, in taqu mithqala habbatin min khardalin fatakun fis samawati aw fil ard ya'ti biha Allah. Say, my son, let me tell you about Allah which you don't know. I said, don't think the size of your deeds doesn't matter to Allah. I said, any deeds that you do, even if it happened to be the smallest deed as the weight of an atom, and the place doesn't matter to Allah either. Whether the action is done in the heavens or on the earth, He said, Ya'ati biha Allah. Allah will bring it to your attention yawm al-qiyamah. And this also comes to mention, to support what Allah said in Surah Al-Zalzala, فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى. Whoever does whatever actions, if it's good and it's smaller like an atom, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you will see it yawm al-qiyamah. If the bad deeds also is as smaller as an atom, it's you will see it though. And that's why Quran says, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. When the books are given to us, الظالم, the oppressor, when he opened the book and he reads it and he see all the details mentioned in that, فيقول, and he says, ما لهذا الكتاب, what a book, لا يغادر صغيرة ولا كبيرة إلا أحصاها, what a book, doesn't leave the smallest action nor the greatest action unless it's mentioned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then responded, وَوَجَدُوا مَا عَمِلُوا حَاضِرًا وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. Allah said, then they will see everything they have done. And remember, Allah said, they will not find me oppressor. I will not do any injustice to any of my servants. Which means, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ, whatever you see in your book is your deeds. Whatever you don't see in your book is because you didn't do it. Everything is recorded and everything will be presented to us yawm al-qiyam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to do the right thing, ya Rabb al-Alameen. My dear brothers and sisters, as we live in at the days of the birth of our dear Prophet, Al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, which is known as Usbu' al-Wahda, the week of unity between the Ummah. Because according to the narration of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they believe that the Prophet was born on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, they believe he was born on the 17th. Now between 12th and 17th is a week. So that week is called what? The week of unity, that Muslims united, that this is the week the Prophet is born. And that's what's called Usbu' al-Wahda, the week of unity among the Ummah. In that sense, we would like to share some light about this great personality from the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ahzab, verse 21, لَكَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنٌ. Many people, we know the Prophet is there to teach us. The Prophet is there to share his wisdom with us. The Prophet is here to answer our questions. All of these, it's wonderful why he's here. And Allah said in Surah Al-Jum'ah, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. In that verse, Allah mentioned few of the things the Prophet does to the Ummah. One of the things that the Prophet does, which we're going to talk about, which Quran says, لَكَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. One of the greatest reasons of having the Prophet among us is that the Prophet is the best and perfect role model for all of us. If you want to look up to someone in every aspect of perfection, Rasulullah is the perfect being for you to look up to. I want to be generous. Who is out there who materialized the generosity better than everyone on this earth? You look at Rasulullah is the best example. I want to look at somebody who is perfect in sincerity, ikhlas. That everything he does is purely for the sake of Allah. Rasulullah is the perfect example. I want to look at somebody in this life who is, when it comes to the mannerism, he is the perfect akhlaq. Who is that person? Al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If I'm looking for somebody in this life who is the symbol of patience, sabr, who can I look up to learn patience? Nobody but Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Every perfection that you're looking for, Al-Rasul is the example. And that's why the ayah says, لَكَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ. Now, Rasulullah is not talking. The Lord of Rasulullah telling you at Rasulullah. Say, لَكَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ. That's indeed, the messenger of Allah is certainly a great example and role model for you. When I said, لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهِ, for those of you who have hope in Allah, looking up for Allah, has a hope in Allah, واليوم الآخر, and hoping to live to see the day of resurrection. And not only that, وذكر الله كثيرا, and those who remember Allah a lot. The Prophet is the perfect example for all of that. So that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to tell us that Rasulullah, Allah sent him to be example for us. And this is where I want to draw our attention, especially our youth. That today, if you're looking for somebody to look up to in your life, remember that it's not about those who are in LA or those Hollywood leaders. That's not your role models. Our role models are Muhammad and Ahlul Muhammad. And your Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is confirming that in this verse. And another ayah, Allah said, no, not only the Rasulullah, if you want to take even another example, Ibrahim also is another example. Ibrahim is another example, role model in your life. And for that matter, today, we want to talk about some of the sunan of the Prophet. Because when we say we are the followers of the Prophet, what does it mean? Does it mean I'm follower of the Prophet by just words, or follower of the Prophet by action? If I'm a follower of the Prophet by action, what are the examples the Prophet left behind? Well, we can materialize that and practice that in order to become the true followers of Rasulullah. One of the examples of being the follower of Rasulullah is to practice the sunnah that the Prophet left behind. But before we go to that, what is the meaning of sunnah? When you say the word sunnah, what does it mean? The word in Arabic, sunnah, means what? Custom. Custom is called what? Sunnah. Now, what does it mean, custom? Something that you do frequently. Give me an example. Let's say after every Jummah, I go to certain store and drink some, let's say, coffee or tea or something. Every Jummah, that's what I do. That's called your sunnah. Example, let's say every morning when I wake up, I do my fajr, I sit down and read Quran. That's called what? Your sunnah. As long as it's good, Islam says, keep on doing that good thing. And by the way, between the parentheses, brothers and sisters, Al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. He tells us, one of the good habits one should adopt is to adopt a good sunnah for yourself. And he says, if you and I are able to adopt a good sunnah, which after our death, somebody continues, we will get thawab like sadaqa al-jariya. Any good habit, sunnah you started, and people continue, or one person continues that sunnah, you will get the thawab. And that is why Rasulullah has so many sunnah. But in Islam, when we say the word sunnah, it means three things. A sunnah in Islam, meaning what? Qawlur Rasul. What the Prophet said. Right? He said, it's not wajib, but I like to do so and so things. That's going to know what sunnah in Islam. Number two, aw fi'luhu, something that he did. And he didn't say it's wajib. Said, I'd like to do these things. Then it becomes what? Sunnah. Number three, taqriru. Taqrir, somebody does something in his presence and didn't stop them. You know what that means? He okays it. Because Rasulullah would not sit to watch somebody doing something haram and not say something about it. So his silence about what somebody did in his presence, it's an indication that it's okay to do it. And that is called what? Sunnah. So in Islam, when we say sunnah, we mean three things. One is what the Prophet says. Two, what he did. Three, what he saw somebody's doing and didn't stop. That becomes a sunnah. Now, this sunnah of the Prophet is a lot. This sunnah, one of our great scholars, Allama Tabatabai, rahmatullah ta'ala alayhi, he combined a book called Sunanun Nabi, where he compiled some of the practices which was known that the Prophet used to do them quite often. And it's what? Authentic as what? And he called the book Sunan al-Nabi, the customs of the Prophet. Now in that book, he mentioned many things, but today I just want to share three things which is mentioned that the Prophet used to do, and it can be another way of life for all of us to learn from Rasulullah and practice those examples you left behind. Because many often times when the year of Milad comes, we hear about the fada'il, we hear about the miracles, and that's it. But these Milads of the Prophet and Ahlul Bayt, we're supposed to learn something and practice it to become better people on a yearly basis. Like this year, the Prophet's birth came. I'm going to learn something new in addition to what I knew about him, and I put it into practice so that my year, this year, is better than the last year about what I know about the Prophet. And that should be on every imam, on every birth. And that is how we grow spiritually. And for that matter, Allama Tabatabai, he mentioned so many ahadith and so many sunan from Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. One of them, which is common that we all can adopt, where he talks about min sunan al-nabi fil malabis, when it comes to the cloth wearing. We all wear clothes every day. Rasulullah wear clothes too. But what was his custom? Alright? That's what we want to learn today. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Allama Tawakkal mentioned that he said, I like of all colors, his favorite colors are two colors. Not haram to wear any other colors. No, it's good, you can wear the colors. But Rasulullah, his favorite colors. What are they? Number one, it says, وَكَانَ يُعْجِبُهُ الثِّيَابُ الْخُضَرِ. He likes green color. And green color, as one of the colors that he dresses and he wears the green cloth for the most part. That is one of the favorite color of Rasulullah. He says, that's number one. Number two, it says, وَكَانَ كَثِيرُ لِبَاسُ الثِّيَابُ الْبَيَاضُ. The Prophet likes what? White clothes. And you know, not only he likes it, he encourages too. And he says, أَكْثِرُ, the Prophet says, أَكْثِرُ مِنْ لِبْسُ الثِّيَابُ الْبَيَاضُ. He said, when you dress, he said, wear a lot of white. Prophet said, I like it. It's a good color. And he said, not only that, he said, وَكَفِّنُوا مَوْتَاكُمْ بِهِ. And then also, when somebody died among you, he said, shroud them with the white cloth too, which is called kafan. Why? Now, this cloth is mustahab in Islam. Now, when we go to Hajj or Umrah, what color do we dress when we go to? That's why it's called what? Ihram. Right? Now, can I wear other colors? Oh, yes, you can. But what it is that the preferable color is white. Good. Why? There are so many reasons behind it. For example, when we shroud the deceased with the white color, there is a hope in it. There's a special dua for it, which says, Allahumma naqqihi min al-dhunubi wal-khataya. كَمَا يُنَكَّ الثَّوْبُ الْأَبْيَدْ مِنَ الدَّنَسِ. Ya Allah, we want you to purify this marhum from all the sins, the way that white cloth can be purified to look pure and clean. Not only that, Ya Allah, this servant of yours, he came with the baggage of sins. But we know that you are Arhamur Rahimin. Ya Allah, accept him without sin, like the way this coffin is clean that we wrapped it. That's one of the hikmah why we wrap the deceased what? With the coffin. So Rasulullah tells us that I like white clothes. He said, wear it in the normal circumstances, and also he said, also wrap your dead bodies with it too when they die. He said, Albisuha ahyaukum. He said, Wakafinu fiha mauta. And do shroud your dead bodies in that. And then he says, I, Rasulullah, I have two different type of clothes that I wear. I have two normal clothes that I dress Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then I have one that I normally dress on Fridays. Which one do you dress, Ya Rasulullah, on Fridays? He said, the white one. I dress white when I go to the Salat al-Jumma. And he says, Rasulullah has two clothes. Two white clothes just for Salat al-Jumma. He keeps it clean so that every Jumma he dresses in that to go to Salat al-Jumma. That is one of the two akhlaq of Rasulullah. One of the custom of Rasulullah. Today, many of us, we have, mashallah, suit for weddings. We have suit for what? For interviews. But we don't have a nice clothes for Jumma. Right? Rasulullah said, I have two that I kept it only for Salat al-Jumma. Because Salat al-Jumma is special. And I want to dress special on those days as well. That is one of the customs of Rasulullah. And not only that, when Rasulullah takes a shirt to wear, what does he say? Does he dress like this and then walk away? What does he say before he put the clothes on? There is a hadith, the Prophet always makes dua before he put the clothes on his body. What does he say? And it's mentioned that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma before he dresses or he wears clothes, he said this dua. Alhamdulillahi alladhi kasani. It's a very short dua. All praise belongs to Allah. Alladhi kasani, who clothed me. Not only that, bima uwari bihi awrati. He blessed me with something that I can cover my body with it. Wa atajammalu bihi fil nas, where I can dress nicely among people. The Prophet, this is his dua before he dresses. Now, one something very important, brothers and sisters. What is this significance? Signifies? Rasulullah, before he dresses, says, Alhamdulillah. Whatever clothes that I have, and I'm dressing myself, right? And I praise Allah, I thank Allah for that blessings. What did Allah say? When you thank me with anything, he said, La in shakartum la azidannahu. Before you dress, you thank Allah. Allah said, I will increase that blessing. And that is what is very important. Before we dress, we always remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's a very short dua. Alhamdulillah alladhi kasani bima uwari bihi awrati wa atajammalu bihi fil nas. All praise belongs to Allah for blessing me with something that I will clothe my body with, and also to cover my body with, and also to look good when I go among people, among human beings. That's one of the sunnah of the Prophet when it comes to our clothing. Now, Rasulullah comes, when he wants to take his clothes off, how does he do it? He dresses with this dua. When he comes, what does he do? They say, Rasulullah, when he comes, before he put the clothes on, he always dressed from the right side. He started with the right side. Now, when he comes to take it off, he takes from the left side. Look at even little things like this, Rasulullah, make sure that it's done properly. That is the sunnah of the Prophet. Now, what are the other customs of Rasulullah? Especially when he sits at the table. When the Prophet sees food, I go to somebody's house. No, in my house, my wife put the food on the table. When I see the food, what do I do? You know, many of us, we look at the food and we try to smell it, try to think whether it's good or not. That's all we think about. Rasulullah, when he sees the food on the table, there is dua for it. Before he touches the food, there is dua for it. When he finishes, there's a dua for it too. Allahu Akbar. This is example with what Imam Ali and Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi wa sallam. You know, it's mentioned that one time Imam Ali alayhi salam was passing by and he saw a bunch of Muslims. They were eating what like normally we do, and they were talking, having conversations, because many of us, when we sit at the table, that's when the politics comes in. We're going to talk about the politics. We're going to talk about who's wrong, who's bad, who's good. We were eating. Good. These people, they were talking. Regular casual talk. Imam Ali passed by and says, Aklun wa kalam? Are you eating and talking? They were like, whoa, 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 wait a minute. Okay, okay. No talking. They start talking. Few days later, Imam Ali passed by them and he saw them. They were eating and they were quiet. Then he says, Aklun wa sukut? Are you eating and quiet? I said, oh, Imam Ali, no, now you're making it so hard. I said, we were eating, talking. He said, as if we should stop. And we did. And now he said, we're eating and quiet? I said, yes. So what should we do? He said, Aklun wa hamd. The custom is Aklun wa hamd. When you eat, you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, many of us, we wait until that, mashallah, we fall, we burp, there's alhamdulillah. All right? Now, the Rasulullah and Ahlul Bayt, they just said, no, while you eating, it's good to keep remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because remember, brothers and sisters, there are two important blessings here. Number one, you having the food on your table is a great blessing. There are people like you somewhere else, they don't have that in the privilege. Not only that, now there are people with you in the same city. They have the food. But because of health reasons, they cannot even eat. They have the food, but they can't. But Allah combined both and give it to you. You have the food. You're healthy, you can chew, you can swallow. Shouldn't that deserve you to thank Allah? And that's what Imam Ali, the Prophet, is telling us. I said, when they put the food on the table and Rasulullah sees the food, what does he say? One of the sunnah of the Prophet is to say this. It says, Allahumma. The Prophet says, oh Allah. It says, Ij'alha. Oh Allah, I ask you to let this food, ni'matun, to be a blessing. Not only that, ni'matun, mashkura. Blessing that we recognize and we thank you for that blessing. Alhamdulillah, Allahumma ja'alha ni'matul mashkura. I say, tasilu biha ni'matul jannah. Ya Allah, I ask you, let it be, this food be a blessing that we thank you for. And not only that, take this blessing, which is on the table, to continue till the blessing that comes in jannah. Mean, ya Allah, connect this blessing of food that on the table to see it also in Jannah as well. That is when the Prophet sees the food on the table. That's the sunnah of the Prophet when he sees the food. Now, what does he say before he starts the food? Now, many of the time we say Bismillah, which is fine, right? But according to the sunnah, the Prophet before he touches the food, he says, Bismillah, I begin in the name of Allah. Then he says, Barik lana fi ma razaqtana. Ya Allah, put your blessing on this blessing that you blessed us with. And then he says, Nar ulida wa alayka, Ya Allah, Khalifa. And Ya Allah, you let this to be what? Continuously, and not take this blessing away from us. That is Rasulullah before he starts the food. Now, when Rasulullah also finish the food and they're taking the place away, what does he say? Another dua. He says, Allahumma, oh Allah, aktharta wa atabta wa barakta fa ashba'ta wa arwayta. Alhamdulillah alladhi yud'imu wa la yud'am. That's the dua after the Prophet finished his meal. What does he mean? He said, Allahumma, oh my Lord, Aktharta, you have given a lot of blessings. Wa atabta, and you give the best one too, pure one. Wa barakta, and you have blessed this food. You know, one of the blessings of the food is that when you eat the food, Allah blesses to become energy, to become blessings in your body. All of this, you have to thank Allah. It says, wa barakta, you bless it. And you made this food to be the means of filling our stomachs. Our waiter, and whatever we drink, you always also use that to quench our thirst. He said, Alhamdulillah. All praise belongs to you, Allah. Who? Alladhi yut'im. He who feeds and nobody feeds him. That is what Rasulullah says. Whenever the Prophet is fed and eats food. That's number two. Number three, which is very important, brothers and sisters. What does the Prophet say when he hears Adhan? Because I know many of time, whenever we hear Adhan, that's when our chit-chat starts. That's when we talk about many things, as if Adhan is not even important. Now, what is the sunnah of the Prophet whenever he hears Adhan? Right? Here, Allama Tabatabai, Rahmatullah Ta'ala Alayh, he mentions, he says, Kana yuraddid. He repeats every word Mu'adhin says. When Mu'adhin says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, he speaks the same thing. When Mu'adhin says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, he says the same thing. Until the Mu'adhin comes and says, Hayya ala salah, Hayya ala al-falah, Hayya ala khayr al-amal, then the Prophet will repeat the same thing and then add, Wala hawla wala quwwata illa billah. On these three things, Hayya ala salah, Hayya ala al-falah, Hayya ala khayr al-amal, he will repeat, and then after that, he will say, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Then what happened when the adhan is said and finished? The Prophet has dua. What is that dua? And he says, Allahumma rabba hadhihi al-da'wati al-tamma wa salati al-qa'imah aati muhammadan suqla يوم القيامة وبعثوا وبعثوا الدرجة الوسيلة من الجنة وتقبل شفاعته في أمته. You know why this is important, brothers and sisters? You know, it's mentioned that at the time of Adhan is the best time Allah accepts du'as. One of the best times Allah accepts the du'a is what? Is when Adhan is called. Now, we have so many hadiths talks about when is the best time to ask Allah things. One of them, according to the narrations, when the rain is falling. That's the best time to do your dua. Number two, one of the best time to ask Allah your dua is when two people are being united in marriage. Number three, when the adhan is being called. That is the time that Allah opens the door and says to my servant, ask and you will be given. But more often time, that's when we forget Allah at that time. But what is the sunnah of the Prophet when they finish Adhan? The Prophet will say, Allahumma, oh my Lord, Rabba hadhihi da'wa, you are the Lord of this call. Which call? The Adhan. At-tama, the complete call. Was-salat al-qa'ima, and the salat that is about to be established. أعطي محمدا سؤله يوم القيامة. يا الله, grant Muhammad his request يوم القيامة. What is the request of Prophet Muhammad يوم القيامة? The dua says, Allah, grant Muhammad his request يوم القيامة. Now, يا الله, what is the request of Muhammad يوم القيامة? The request of Muhammad يوم القيامة is to do shafa as much for his ummah. That's the request of the Prophet. So you're asking Allah, you say, Aati Muhammadan, su'lahu yawm al-qiyamah. Ya Allah, grant Muhammad his request yawm al-qiyamah. I said, not only that, وَبَعَثُوا الدَّرَجَةَ الْوَصِيلَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. And ya Allah, elevate him to the highest level in Jannah. And not only that, وَتَقَبَّلْ شَفَاعَتَهُ فِي أُمَّتِهِ. And accept his shafa'a among his ummah yawm. This is the dua of Rasulullah after every adhan, which is the best time to make dua. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to materialize this sunnah of the Prophet, Ya Rabb al-Alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you, help us to do this musta'abbat, Ya Rabb al-Alamin. Ya Allah, help us to echo and follow the steps of Rasulullah. And Ya Allah, we ask you, let us be among the true servants of Rasulullah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر صلوا على محمد وآل محمد الله بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين ثم الصلاة والسلام على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل وسلم على علي أمير المؤمنين وعلى فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين وعلى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة أجمعين وعلى علي بن الحسين زين العابدين ومحمد بن علي باقر علم النبيين وجعفر بن محمد الصادق وموسى بن جعفر الكاظم وعلي بن موسى الرضا ومحمد بن علي الجواد وعلي بن محمد الهادي والحسن بن علي الأسكري والحجة بن الحسن المهدي أجل الله تعالى فرجه وسهل الله مخرجه وجعلنا وإياكم من الطالبين بدمه وجعلنا الله وإياكم من المستشهدين بين يديه جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear brothers and sisters, one of the event of this week is the anniversary of the marriage between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam and Khadija alayhi salam. This great prophet is also another example in marriages. Today, we hear so much divorces in our societies and communities. Today, if you have 10 marriages in 1 month, by the end of the month, you're lucky if you get half of it to stay married. Many of the marriages that is undone today is mostly end up in divorces. Why is it that we have Rasulullah as an example who lived all his life and never happened to do even one divorce in his life? And we are the friends of Rasulullah, but we cannot keep marriages. We look at the life of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, right? Our Imam Ali alayhi salam married Imam al-Hasan, Imam al-Husayn. Not even single one we ever recorded that they divorced someone. But when he come to us as a Shia, as a follower, we divorced left and right. What happened? What is the secret that they have taught and we are not following? We need to go back and learn how Rasulullah lived with Khadija alayhi salam. How they lived a very peaceful life together till the end of their life. They miss each other. Rasulullah, even after Khadija was passed, after her death, Rasulullah always talk about Khadija. Because of this life that they share together. Because of the sacrifice they did to one another. This is the example we need to learn from. The same thing Imam Ali with Fatima alayhi salam. Today, one of the things that we miss in our marriages is what? Number one, we don't understand that marriage is an act of worship. Look at the marriage as I love her, she loves me, okay, let's get married. That's what we think about marriage. Well, marriage is beyond that. Marriage is an act of ibadah. The way that you make wudu, you stand before Allah and you do your salat, that is how marriage is supposed to be looked at. It's an act of ibadah. And more importantly, brothers and sisters, we have to get this in our minds and hearts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you, this life is a life of tests. Sometimes your husband is your test. Sometimes your wife is your test. Yes. So does it mean that I have to divorce her because she's my test? Absolutely not. Yes, I'm not saying that to stay in the marriages or relationship that is abusive and then what does it? No, I'm not saying that. But sometimes there are little things that we can deal with. There are little things we can be patient with them and live together, especially when there are children among, especially when there are children involved. Today we live at a time like the way we live in America, in the West. Today, you know that many of many things, I buy a watch, it's not working, throw it, let me get a new one. My TV is not working, throw it, let me get a new one. One is going to come, inshallah, on Black Friday, I'll get a new one. All right? My shoes are not, let me throw it, get out. Now, that's the mentality with the marriages too. If she doesn't work, divorce her, get another one. If he doesn't listen, get away, get rid of him, get another one. Okay, good. You can get another one. But let me ask you, the next one that you're getting, is she Ali ibn Abi Talib? Perfect descendant from the sky? Or is another human being like you too? Now, if he's a man, you're going to rid of her. Now, the one that you want to marry, is she Khadija alayhi salam? Perfect one from the heaven? That I'm not going to... Everyone that you're going to marry, she will have issues. Because it's the sunnah of life. You can never find a woman that is perfect from all angles. The way that you are not perfect, she's not perfect too. But what you need to do is to work together and grow together. You look at each other at fault and you help each other to grow. I know her flaws. She knows my flaws. We help each other to become a better people. That's what marriage is for. But if I want to look over and say, no, I don't want, because you do this mistake or you are not this perfect, so I'm going to rid of it, then there's no marriage. That's where we need to learn, brothers and sisters. And listen, when you go to the hadith, you being patient with your wife, bad akhlaq, or your husband, bad akhlaq, there is so much thawab involved. But the best thing is what? We need to go back and learn the life of Khadija and Rasulullah. How do they live with each other? How do they talk to each other? That's how we can learn to build our marriages and keep our marriages happy, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to do so, ya Rabbil Alam. The last, not the least, there was a flood in Nigeria in the city called Maiduguri, where there is a lot of lives were lost, a lot of properties were destroyed, there is a lot of things was damaged. Our prayers and thoughts goes to all of those individuals who were affected with this flood in Nigeria. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for all of them, ya Rabbil Alameen. And we're remembering our brothers and sisters also in Lebanon, which took out, there were some explosions where some people lost their life recently and some people were injured in that incident. Our prayers and thoughts goes to those who lost their lives and those who got injured in this tragedy. May Allah protect the people of Lebanon, ya Rabbil Alameen. And also remembering our brothers and sisters in Gaza, our brothers and sisters in Palestine. We cannot ignore them, brothers and sisters. It is our responsibilities as a Muslim to worry about any person, especially Muslim, who is being oppressed in any corner of the earth. We need to be concerned about them. We need to be concerned about their status. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help them, ya Rabbil Alameen. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring victory to them, ya Rabbil Alameen. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every corner of the earth where a human being is being oppressed, ya Allah, turn them to become victorious, ya Rabbil Alameen. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, inna atainaka al-kawthar, wa salli li rabbika wanhar, inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.